Welcome to another addictive episode of the Ocean Sailing Podcast with your host and sailing addict, David Howes.
Hey folks, welcome to episode 92 of the Ocean Sailing Podcast. This week's a great episode with a really incredible young man with a fascinating story and a fascinating outlook on life. And I've not met anybody else in my life, let alone a 25-year-old that has had 100 million views on YouTube of his adventures. Firstly, as a liverboard on a van traveling around South America, and then more recently he's put that aside and jumped on board a yacht in the Mediterranean and his continuing life on the water. So Dylan Magaster, spelled M-A-G-A-S-T-E-R, is a fascinating young man, and this is certainly a bumper episode, and I really loved his philosophy and outlook on life, and there's some great lessons to take out of it, particularly if you're in a position where you're thinking about making a change or doing something different, and in that kind of paralysis mode where you sort of struggle to get going. He's got some good tips and advice. So on the personal front, a couple of things for me. The Silver Fern yacht that I am in the process of purchasing, the 72-footer in New Zealand, is coming along pretty nicely, but I won't sort of dwell on that here. But if you want to follow the updates, I've been posting a weekly or fortnightly update on the progress on the acquisition of the Silver Fern yacht and my expansion of the Ocean Sailing Expeditions business. So go check that out on the Ocean Sailing Expeditions Facebook page, or if you're a member of the Ocean Sailing Podcast Facebook group, I share that video update there on a weekly, fortnightly basis when there's news to report. So, and then I guess the other thing I want to just touch on before we jump into episode 92 with Dylan is recently I got some great news from Maritime New Zealand, and that they had completed their formal investigation into my Hobart to Picton crossing in March. And if you followed that episode a couple of crew interviews afterwards, you'll know that we lost our steering cable partway across the Tasman. We handsteered for a period of time with emergency tiller, and then eventually lost that, and followed by the loss of the autopilot, and ultimately were rescued and towed to safety by the New Zealand Coast Guard Nelson team. And so off the back of that, as always, whether you know you're a cruise liner or a fishing trawler or a sailing yacht, there's an investigation into what happened, how it came about, what steps you took to prevent it, and they go all the way back to before you departed Hobart. Safety training for the crew, were they trained and confident, was the boat set up properly, etc. And so interestingly, when they told me they would be investigating a crossing, and that there are fines, there can be jail time, and along with you know, public shaming involved if you're deemed guilty of misconduct or mishandling a yacht as a skipper, or not taking, you know, the right sort of steps health and safety wise. So while I wasn't overly concerned, when I went to do my 90-minute interview with the investigator, and he asked if I'd like to have a lawyer present, and whether I'd like to have a lawyer screen the questions, because the information could be used against me in a court of law, I kind of thought it was you know, reasonably serious sort of I guess process. And my approach was, you know, as I think Robert De Niro said in the movie The Irishman, it is what it is. My attitude was, what happened was what happened, and we did our best in terms of preparation, planning, adapting to a changing situation, and ultimately the outcome was we kept the boat in one piece and the crew in one piece, and got to safety. So that kind of was my attitude, and so I talked openly to their investigator, and I guess shared background story going back several years. Really, they go right back to when did you start sailing, and you know, how much have you done. And I encouraged all of the crew, which all five of them, to just speak openly to the investigator and let them put into their own words, which they progressively did over a period of time, given they were spread across Australia, New Zealand, and the United States. I rang the other day to say, hey guys, do you have an update? Because time is marching on. And they said, didn't we get back to you? Sorry, investigation is closed. We're very happy with the entire process, everything you did. And mostly, and I guess this is a lesson I wanted to share, they said, we were most impressed about the positive, proactive approach that you and your crew took, with being open and transparent with us, sharing the story. That alone helped to color the outcome in the sense that we didn't feel like you were trying to conceal or hide anything, or that there was any sort of unnecessary attempt to corroborate a story. So I want to share that lesson because probably unlikely you end up in that position. But as he said, they investigate everything from blow-up lilos that go to sea right through to cruise ship liners that sink, and everything in between. And so they take a pretty, pretty objective approach. But it just shows you that if you just if you tell it as it happened and tell it as it was and explain what your intentions were and everything you did to prevent it and avoid it and adapt to this situation, then these people are also people too on the other end of the investigation, and they appreciate the openness of and willingness and the cooperation of the crew. So I thought it was just a good lesson to share. So we're going to jump into this week's episode 92 with Dylan Magaster. I highly recommend that you check out Dylan on Instagram, Facebook, and YouTube. I'm going to link to those channels from the oceansailingpodcast.com/podcast page. But he's a fantastic young man. It's a great episode. I really enjoyed it, and I think you'll get a lot out of it. So enjoy this week with Dylan.
Right now, I'm in Tunisia. How are you doing?
I'm doing well, thank you. Thanks for setting up this interview because reading your story and looking at your background, what a fascinating character.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
So thanks for setting that up. The audio is good. The video is good. And it's good to have you on the Ocean Sailing Podcast. And when I first received the contact from you, when I read your name, I read it and it looked like Dylan Magaster, and I guess it's pronounced Magaster or something. Like, how do you pronounce your surname? Because it looks very close to Megastar. And when you said Magaster with like 100 million YouTube views, I thought, oh, who is this crazy guy?
Yeah, it's Dylan Magaster. So like M-A and then Gaster, Magaster.
Cool. Okay, so I figured that. In terms of, by way of introduction and reading a little bit about your background, watching your intro video on the Dylan Magaster YouTube channel, it's December 2015, which is not that long ago, but the world's changed a lot since then. You're pretty young, 21, not feeling that great about life.
Yeah, definitely.
And you kind of used some air points to buy a ticket to South America and up and headed off to Paraguay and with $1,000 in your pocket. And sometime later, Argentina, Chile, Peru, I think you did the circuit a couple of times and then ended up back in Massachusetts squid fishing and managed to save $1,800 and buy a van for $2,000. And somehow here we are today, 5 years later, and you've got a film company in LA, the CEO of. You've had 100 million views on YouTube of your adventures. You've bought a yacht and gone sailing. I mean, that's incredible for a young guy. It really is.
Thank you.
I don't even know where to start talking to somebody like you, because that's just a fascinating story.
Thank you. Yeah, it's worked out all right, all things considered. It's been tough and it's not conventional by any means. To what people would expect to happen, or how to go about even like getting a sailboat. But I've kind of, figured out how to maneuver through it in a way that works for me and in a way that, getting into the whole sailing and yachting world, the full-time cruising world, because now I've lived on the sailboat for about 2 years, I was able to do that without, I was able to do it in a very cost-effective manner, opposed to a lot of people think that getting into sailing is like quite an expensive endeavor. And I mean, it's not cheap, but I was like lucky enough to get a boat for a really cheap price and then able to figure that out and still make money while doing the whole thing while living on the sea. And so that's made it all kind of possible, is the internet, really.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, you're a really interesting person to talk to, because you're a great example of, you know, the pathways that are available now, really. And it does take some creative thinking. It takes putting a stake in the ground and, you know, giving out, you know, what you're either comfortable or uncomfortable with, and taking a leap of faith. But it is amazing now with if you're resourceful, what you can do and what you can live on income-wise, in terms of how little that can be, between your sailing or traveling, but equally what's available now in terms of income opportunities, particularly when you do what you do and capture your travels in a really, really incredible way and share those to inspire other people. You know, I take my hat off to you, because people like you encourage people at all ages to move out of their comfort zone and get out of the rat race and go do something, sell up and sail, or sell up and travel. And I think I was talking to somebody a month ago about some of the people I sail with, and I think we're adventurers at heart rather than sailors at heart. The boat's just sort of a means of getting there, but it's really about the adventure rather than the sailing, whether that's by land or by sea. You know, I think this is probably a better term for it, really.
Yeah, I was thinking about that just earlier today, about the sport of sailing. And I'm not like into the sport of sailing, as far as like, I don't keep up with the sailing cup. I don't even know what it's called, the sailing cup or whatever, or like any of the famous sailors. I don't keep up with any of that kind of stuff. I like to sail because it's a fun way to get around. It makes me like completely responsible for my surroundings and movement and all of that. And then all the aspects of like being skipper and then operating a sailboat and managing a crew, and then having the benefit of having your house with you, being able to cross seas, go to different countries, and then just the aspect of getting to the other country ends up being its whole adventure in itself. And then I mean, the freedom aspect that comes with that, and then all the responsibility that comes with that, it's like that's what is the motivation more than the sailing. Because when I got into sailing, I didn't know anything about sailing, really. I didn't grow up with it. I grew up in Kansas, landlocked, and so like I didn't have any sailing culture. And so for me, very much the motivation is the adventure aspect, like you were saying.
That's really fascinating, because I have some common passions as well. It's, you know, it is about the elements and like the mixtures different every day, and the crew and the dynamics and the boat and the challenges and the uncertainty. That's what makes it exciting. The fact is there's a boat involved, I think it's part of it, but it's not everything. The fact that you can be self-sufficient and take control of your own little part of the world. You know, what's the weather doing today? Where are we going today? What are we eating next? Like, that's about as complicated as it gets, right, when you're sailing.
Yeah, you end up having I was thinking about it the other day, you end up like managing a microcosm, right? Like a miniature world, a miniature universe, because when you're out at sea, you are self-sufficient. And so I mean, nothing else matters when you're out at sea except for like what's going on with the boat and the weather. Everything else, political or whatever, is completely non-factor. Because then those skills, they branch out to the rest of your life, right? Because you, learning how to manage a world, a miniature world, then helps you manage your life and all of that kind of stuff. But, I really like it. But the whole idea of like boats and sailing, was initially kind of second to the adventure and the exploration and like pushing myself and seeing if I could do it and seeing if I could like make it happen.
I totally agree. And I did a sailing course once, and this is a few years ago before I crossed the Tasman Sea for the first time, and the guy that was the sailing teacher, if you like, he said, when you're out there on the ocean, you're master under God. There's no one else out there and no one else to report to, and that's all you gotta worry about.
Definitely. Well, I was just gonna say, learning that, just the idea of like skipper or captain, that if you're on the boat, anything that happens, no matter what, is your responsibility. It doesn't matter what happens. It doesn't matter if your crew makes a mistake, it's still my fault, right? Like that whole concept is really important to learn, but also like kind of initially hard to come to terms with and hard to understand of like, oh no, it's their fault. It's not their fault because I didn't train them properly or something like that, or I didn't give proper guidance. And so it really all comes back to like, if there's any issues on the boat, it's because of some form of like a lack of leadership on the skipper's end, which is really hard. Like it like bashes your ego because like if something's going wrong, you're like, yeah, I guess it's my fault. Dang. But then that also liberates you and gives you the freedom because it's like, yeah, it is my responsibility. So I'm the one that has to solve this problem. And obviously you do that with input and opinions of the people around you and the crew and like get their input. But like fundamentally it's the skipper's responsibility. And I like that.
Yeah. That's a great way of looking at it. And it's a pretty refreshing view of life really, because you know, it doesn't matter who caused the problem. It doesn't matter who you want to blame. You can't just clock out and go home at 5 o'clock. If you're out in the middle of the ocean, no matter what's gone wrong, you've got to fix it, right? And yeah, sometimes as a skipper, you actually don't know what you need to do to fix it. And it really does force some good, I guess, leadership lessons and team building lessons, because you don't have a choice but to figure it out. And sometimes you don't have the answers, but it is amazing when you have a crew that collectively work it out. You know, it's a great exercise, and it really bonds people together. But the irony is you don't have a choice, do you? Like, you don't have a choice. You have to deal with what you have to deal with, whether it's convenient or not.
Yeah. Well, and I like that aspect of it too, that like not having a choice, because some problems, whether it's like with the boat or with just whatever, like in life, you don't want to deal with. And like, unless you're forced to deal with them, you just don't, right? Like, you're just like, yeah, I just won't deal with it. But being out, that's not an option. Like, you have to deal with it. Like you said, you don't have a choice. And so I think that then spills over into the rest of at least my life. But yeah, that's like all those aspects are things that are like fundamental and integrated into sailing that people don't see when they like see photos and videos of people sailing. They think, oh, you know, it's romantic, we're on a beach and everything like that. And it's like, that's not even what keeps people sailing. I mean, the being on the beach, it's fantastic and I love it, but like everything that we've just been discussing to me is what keeps me sailing, and I think is what keeps a lot of people sailing, because the other stuff is kind of shallow and hollow to some degree.
Yeah, I completely agree. And that's what makes it rewarding as well. It would be pretty boring if you didn't have those challenges to overcome that you then get a lot of satisfaction out of overcoming.
Yeah.
That don't fit your plan. And it's right. I mean, a lot of people spend a lot of their life kind of procrastinating or avoiding or putting stuff in a box and saying, I'll come back to it later. When you're saying you live in the now, you have no choice but to live in the now. Mm-hmm. And if you don't live in the now, then, you know, things generally deteriorate. So, you know, it's great from a life lessons point of view. So, like, I'm really always really interested to understand what the catalyst or the driver or the sort of the point at which somebody said, so I'm going to do something different with my life. And so when we go back to you and you're, you know, age 21, 5 years ago, like through your childhood or teenage years, the way you grew up, the adventure you had or didn't have, or how school was or wasn't for you, you know, when you look back, was there a point which you sort of said, I kind of just don't fit in the box and I've got this passion for adventure as opposed to just some system and some job and some, you know, 9-to-5 type life?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I luckily I was able to like stay out of trouble all throughout high school and junior high for the most part. But in high school and then in like the first years of community college, I didn't actually go to university. I ended up dropping out of community college, but me and some friends, we would go and explore abandoned places. We really liked doing that. Go find abandoned buildings downtown, go check them out, look inside, go take a bunch of photos, maybe climb on the roofs of some buildings that we're not supposed to be on, you know, like things that aren't recommended by society, but are more or less harmful, more or less not harmful, and harmless. And so we would do that a lot. And I loved doing that, loved exploring and loved seeing things that, because with abandoned buildings, you're kind of seeing something, when you see it, it's in the state that it's in, but it's always changing. Because if you go back 5 years later, it's going to be a different place. And then there's some like abandoned sites that, they're scheduled to be torn down and rebuilt. So you're actually, it's like reverse exploration. And like, Neil Armstrong was the first man to explore the moon. It's like, we're kind of the last people to explore this place before it gets destroyed, and document it. And so I like doing that a lot. And that was kind of my first, like self-propelled exploration kind of things. And then I started traveling, taking road trips and whatnot. But I was going to be a pastor, and then I decided I wanted to be a cook. I really liked cooking. And then I started working in a country club in the kitchen doing catering and line work. And I kind of realized that that wasn't for me. It wasn't working for me. And so then, it was like, well, I want to travel. I know I want to travel. And that was a mix of a few different things. One of them being, how much I saw on the internet, right? Like you get exposed to how big the world is, from seeing things online. And it was like, wow, I've got to see that. And then the opportunities that we have now in terms of, you know, commercial airplanes and how cheap the flights are relatively to what they used to be. And just how fast you can move across the planet. Like it was impossible to do that, just a few generations ago. And so there was this mix of, desire from like knowing that I needed to get out of where I grew up, because I grew up in Olathe, Kansas, and there's just not a whole lot going on there. It's not like a podunk town or anything like that, but it's in the plains. There's not mountains, there's not a sea, there's not a whole lot of outdoor recreation that you can do out there. And so I knew I wanted to start traveling. And so then I just kind of started trying to figure out how can I do this, because I didn't have any money. I was making decent money because I was doing carpentry and construction, which I kind of grew up doing with my father. He does like home remodeling, and he's done all sorts of stuff, built bridges and all sorts of stuff as a laborer. And so I used the internet and learned about travel hacking, about how you can use credit cards to gain points and then use that to travel. So it's like a relatively passive way of like getting free money. Basically, it's like, as long as you keep up with your payments, pay everything off at the end of the month, you don't have to pay interest. And then they reward you with free money, because their whole thing is like, they want you to spend more money and then like get sucked into the credit hole loop. But if you're responsible and you're aware of the game they're playing, then you can kind of game that system and get the benefits from it. So I learned that from a few different websites. And so I started doing that. When I bought my camera, I put all that on credit, then paid it off at the end of the month. And it was like, boom, I already got like 150,000 points just from that. And so that allowed me to then fly to South America for $17. So the catalyst, I mean, was, I don't know exactly what it was, but it was a mix of being, like not comfortable or not satisfied with where I was in life. And then I've kind of always had this feeling as if like I was behind, like I was running behind and I needed to catch up, in life. And so that's been like a propelling force. And then the, personal need for me to see the world and see what's out there. Because I'd like been realizing that to some degree, as we all are, I was brainwashed by my culture into thinking some things. And then I started questioning that. And I was like, no, I need to like go see what's out there, because people are saying things that just doesn't make sense to me, type of thing.
It is amazing the things that lead up to making a decision like that. But then when you look back, it's kind of like, well, that just made sense. It was just a natural progression. But sometimes when you're looking forward, it's a bit scary and a bit uncertain. Tell me about FLORB in terms of, you know, that's a like a media company, really, like a video production company, right? Based in LA and California, which sounds pretty exotic compared to the plains of Kansas. How did you evolve from traveler and adventurer into, well, I can capture and share this, and, you know, people want to see this stuff.
Right. So when I started traveling, I've pretty much only ever worked while I've traveled, because like you had mentioned, when I flew to South America, I had $1,000. So figuring out how to make money on the road was essential for me. And so as soon as I left, and even before I left, I was working on building a YouTube channel and building a career on YouTube. I had made the decision that I was going to make a career on YouTube. That's just what I decided I was going to do. And so I started doing that when I was traveling, and it evolved. I had multiple different, went through different channel variations of different styles of content that like didn't work, and then eventually landed on what we create on FLORB, which is short documentaries on alternative styles of living, right? So like people that live in tiny houses, people that live in vehicles, people that live in domes, tree houses, eco-village, just anything that is not conventional is what we make short documentaries about. And so I came to creating that while traveling, and made the first kind of episode up in the northeast of America, so in New England. And that just eventually evolved into creating a production company. So for the first multiple years, it was just me doing everything. And it was really hard. It was a lot of work. And it's still hard and a lot of work. But it partly because we do a lot more now than I was doing then. But now we've got, I started the company Floating Orb Productions, which is what FLORB is. So FLORB is the brand. FLORB is a contraction of the two words floating orb, because we live on a floating orb in space, which is just like insane. And so I figured that was a great name. Somehow that came to me. I was like, that's great. It's one syllable. It's totally memorable. I like it. It sounds funny. And it's got a kind of deep meaning to it, sort of, that I like. And so, yeah, now we've got, you know, three of us are working full time. We're in the process of bringing on a fourth. And then we've got other contractors that we work with as well. And so we produce and operate two different YouTube channels, right? So we've got FLORB, which is a short documentaries. And then recently we ramped up a second YouTube channel, which is just self-titled Dylan Magaster. And this is all focused on like the sailing and adventure. And it really goes into like philosophy and kind of like what you would want or imagine you would get out of traveling, right? Like not just we went from A, point A to point B, and this is what happened. It's like we went from point A to point B, and this is how it changed me as a person. And this is like what I learned from it, and the philosophies of that, and more the like deep core aspects of like why travel is fundamentally important, and the lessons learned in that. And so we just recently ramped that up, and I'm really happy with how the videos have come out and how they're coming together. And so, yeah, now we're operating both those channels, and then we've got a Facebook page and just the other social medias and whatnot. But, yeah, we're in the process still of expanding. We're a new production company in comparison to, you know, the giants in L.A. But, so that's kind of how it started. It all kind of evolved while traveling.
It's fascinating. And, I mean, in terms of your evolution in terms of like the psychology behind all this, like if I take my experience, right, you start off sailing, you think I know very little, and you learn as you go, and then, and even in my podcasting experience over the last 4 years, the majority of the content I did was talking to other people, and then more recently I probably share a lot more about my experiences, which I get great feedback on. Like, for you, was there a point at which you actually decided, actually, I'm a bit of an authority on this. I've got a perspective to share. I've got an opinion to share. I've got a philosophy to share, and people want to listen to that. They want to understand. They want to follow it. Like, did that just like happen from the get go, or did you get to a point where you actually thought, actually, I've got a really good perspective and a view on this that people want to listen to it? And did you get confidence to really grow into your role of, I guess, you know, being a leader in this alternative lifestyle area, and openly sharing your thoughts and all the challenges, everything that go wrong, without actually having to stop and think about maybe what the audience wants, is just being able to be sort of, I guess, unmasked and unscripted and just be yourself?
So when I started traveling, I was making like a travel series, like a travel vlog, and I made 200 something episodes of that, and then I ended up stopping because at the time, I was like 21, I was broke, traveling, backpacking, and it wasn't performing particularly well on YouTube, but I had this realization of like, because I was making a video almost every single day, and I was like, dude, nobody cares like what I'm doing. Like, nobody cares. I'm this 21-year-old. I have like hardly any life experience. I'm just traveling around and like doing this YouTube thing. And it just clicked in my mind. Like, why would anybody care about this? Like, they wouldn't. I wouldn't. And so then I ended up switching up the content. And then when I made the decision to move on to the sailboat, we started documenting again, because I figured that, this is a shift that I think a lot of people would want to do in their life, make a shift from going of living one type of life to living on a sailboat. Not everybody, but I'm sure there's some people that would like to do that. And then I'm sure there's a lot of people that would like to do that that don't have any experience with sailing and they don't know how to do it. And so that was kind of like, okay, this could be valuable to people and entertaining to people, because I'm coming from this background of having pretty much no experience moving onto a sailboat and kind of doing everything like that. And so that was kind of the reasoning behind starting the sailing series initially. But then when I moved onto the sailboat, just between all the learning and then the operating of the two channels, it was just way too much. And so I ended up having to like stop doing the sailing stuff for a little while. And it took me about a year and a half, more or less, to kind of get everything balanced and sorted to be able to ramp up this second channel. And so we had been posting that, like, if you want to see the first year and a half, the first year of sailing, that's on FLORB. You can find that on FLORB under playlist. But then once we stopped posting for a while, and then when we started posting again, we ramped up a second channel. And now we've got all that kind of balance so we can manage it all and create at a regular pace. But it took some setting up to figure that out. But the idea of like having something to say, or feeling as if my opinion is valid, like one of the things that I know is that I don't know everything at all. And I know that some opinions that I have are incorrect. But I don't know which ones those are, right? Like that's the fundamental problem, is like you know you're wrong, you just don't know where you're wrong. And so when it comes to sharing my perspectives and ideas and philosophies, like I've been pretty much obsessed with philosophy since I was young. And that first kind of manifested in like the studying of the New Testament, and then mainly the New Testament, the Old Testament as well, but and then that's expanded into other religions and other philosophies as I've gotten older. And so then seeing how that, some of those ideas manifest themselves in my life. And then also because I've been traveling for, 4.5 years now, full time, basically. And a large amount of that time I did solo travel, so I was alone. And so I've spent a lot of time alone, and I've come to really enjoy alone time, and come to really enjoy like time to like sit and think and reflect and just like ponder and go down different thought experiments and stuff like that. I really like that. And so I appreciate the silence and in the lifestyle that I've been able to create so that I can do that. And because I've done that a lot, I think that, and because of like the experiences I've had and the way I view the world, I think that it provides a perspective that a lot of people don't have or have never heard, because they, some reason or another, they haven't had the opportunity to be able to spend the time alone and experience the things that I've experienced. So like, yeah, I know that I'm not right on everything, but I think that just expressing what it is that I think, or ideas that I go through. And, I heard from, I don't remember who it was, but just the concept of like, I don't even necessarily believe everything I say. I just like to entertain the ideas and then see if there's something valid in that that's useful, right? Like, I think it's really valuable to, yeah, just like have a thought experiment, go down it. If it's like super messed up, okay, just go down it and see where it goes and then see if there's something to be learned from that. But whether or not that's like, I believe that, it's like kind of irrelevant to me. If it logically makes sense or it's an interesting path, I think it's worth exploring just to see what's there. And so, I kind of realized that. In that I love philosophy and I love telling stories, and I live a relatively interesting life now, it all kind of came together into, I think I can really make these videos that are impactful and valuable to people, both in entertainment and hopefully in some sort of perspective shifting manner. But we'll see what happens. I mean, just kind of creating the best stuff that we can, and we're happy with how it turns out.
That's a really, really fascinating way of looking at life, Dylan. And that's for somebody your age. I mean, it's a lot of wisdom in that. There really is. I listened to a guy once who was a keynote speaker at some sort of event or launch or something. He owned a lot of commercial property, and people said to him, and this guy's in his 70s at this stage, what do you think the secret to your success was? And he said, I just take time to think. I spend time on myself. And he literally said to the audience, most of you only think when you're sitting on the toilet, because that's about the only time you're by yourself. You're not on your device, you're not on the phone,
people
took more time to think.
Take the phone in with them.
That's what people do now. But you just spend time thinking, because he said, unless you think, you can't imagine the future. You just keep repeating today. You do the same thing tomorrow and next week. And that thinking time, I mean, I love working with a crew. I love working with people. I love being with people. But equally, I'm never lonely. I mean, if I'm on my boat by myself, I have the greatest time. I never feel lonely. There's just the time to breathe and think and ponder, and as human beings, part of our challenge is we are so overloaded by inbound communication, and so much stimulus from so many directions that taking the time to think and slowing your brain down and thinking about and blocking out everything around you, that's part of the challenge, because it's amazing how. It is amazing how on it's, I think Stephen Covey, one of my my mentors, in terms of he wrote the Seven Habits book. He said on the far side of complexity is usually a simple solution, but most of us have to complicate our lives massively to find the simplicity that we're actually chasing. And planning such an analogy for life. It's so, in so many ways, for life, for business, for whatever. But it's with sailing, it's always when you get to the simplicity, it's just the most beautiful thing. And for life, we are all so guilty of making life unnecessarily complicated. And simplicity is still there, right? And sailing forces you to get back to simplicity and also liberates you. I mean, I love it when, you get 10 miles off the coast, your phone's lost the signal, now you've got no coverage, no phone calls, no emails, just like off the grid. And so, it is that still exists, right? And I agree with you. It's easier to travel now than ever in our lives. Like the information that's out there, the places we can go, the ways we can earn income from being online or producing content or what have you, not being in a day job, doing stuff labor-wise with our hands. I mean, I think it's never been easier. And I've met so many inspirational people like you that are in their 20s and 30s that just, that aren't, deeply concreted to life or shackled to life in a way that they find it too hard to tear themselves away. And, I salute you for what you do and where your travels have taken you already. And, I think that, I'm sure already, probably even within the first 12 months, you can look back on your experiences, and that's more than most people can press into a lifetime, let alone the last 5 years and let alone what lays ahead. So, it's fascinating, and it takes a lot of guts. It takes a lot of guts to just put it out there and go in a direction, particularly traveling alone.
you know, you got to figure stuff out, and you haven't got a, and you haven't, you know, and there's not a lot of money in the bank account. You got, you know, you are literally figuring out how to feed yourself from week to week and having to solve problems. Yeah. But my goodness, we have got such a rich planet in terms of culture and, you know, sea life and coastal kind of beauty. And, you know, if we all spend more time doing that and appreciating each other, we'll probably spend less time, you know, having a maybe a bit more of a limited view of the world and be less appreciative of other cultures. If you look at some of the, you know, protests that are going on right now, it's just a lack of understanding, a lack of compassion, a lack of travel, a lack of probably traveling and exploring as well.
Yeah. Well, that's one of the things that becomes very apparent whenever you travel to multiple different cultures, is that people are just people. It's just humans. There are smart people and there are dumb people and there are cool people and there are not cool people. And like, it's just people though. Like it completely shatters any, icons you have of the idea of like police and government and officials and everything like that, because you experience people in official, right? They've got a badge or whatever and they're completely incompetent, and then you meet ones that are very competent, and then you talk to somebody who is in some sort of position like that but they're not on the job right now, and you're like, oh, this is just a regular person, and then you realize, oh, the whole world is just run by people. Just people, just like me, just like you, that have, they have insecurities, they have dreams, they have good days, they have bad days, they have problems they're trying to solve, they have things that are going right, they have, all that kind of stuff. And that gets, there's no way to separate those things from whatever it is that they're doing, right? Like whatever job it is that they have, if it's some official position or not, it's like, you can't dehumanize a job that much to actually remove the human aspect of it, no matter how hard people try with like standardizing and institutionalizing some different careers. But it kind of blows the whole thing out of the water of like, no, there's good people on all parts of the globe and there's bad people on all parts of the globe, and there's no reason to have those prejudgments. Like the only way that you would come to having like prejudices is if you've had many different actual experiences with people of some similar culture, and then you realize like, oh, this is a, because there are differences in cultures, right? Like there is a difference between Greek culture and American culture and Australian culture. We're all people and we have the same fundamental, you know, like characteristics, but as far as the actual culture, it's different. The whole idea of like judging people on skin tone and stuff like that just becomes so obviously dumb that it's like, if there is any judgment, it's based on the culture they come from, not what color their skin is.
Yeah, that's right. And it speaks about more about the people that are doing the judging or have the prejudice than people out of the target. Because, I mean, I've been traveling everywhere in the world, but I've been to a lot of places, and that people just have the same needs everywhere. They love their family. They want a home. They want a good meal. They love having a laugh. They love connecting with other people. You know, people aren't, it's nothing to do with religion or race or skin color. They just, at their core, and even people that you meet that at times, you know, can cause you some grief. Often they're just troubled people with things going on they can't fix, and they take their frustration out on others. But most people aren't even bad people at their core. Sometimes they just have stuff that they're not dealing with very well, and they're just misunderstood, or they just come from a tough background or a tough upbringing. It's amazing the good you see in people. Like if you see the good in them, you'll find good everywhere, you know?
Yeah, definitely. In the it's like tough background or whatever, there's things that drive people to do things, and like, you know, people like to idealize themselves and think that, oh, if I was in this position, I wouldn't have done that thing. And it's like, no, you don't know that because you haven't actually been in that position before. And it's like, unless you've been in that position that that person is in, you don't know that you wouldn't do that. You like to think you wouldn't or that you'd do something better, but you just don't know. And that's also something that I feel like you get taught with sailing is like when you're in a stressful situation, before you start sailing, you're like, yeah, I'm, you know, tough guy. I just keep my cool and all that kind of, and then you get put in like a really stressful situation. And that's where the rubber meets the road of you really understand of like, what are you made out of? And like, how do you actually act under these type of circumstances? And then once you know how you actually act, then you can like work on it and build it and get better at it. But unless you've actually had an experience, you don't know how you would act.
Yeah, that is so true. And there's lots of armchair and keyboard experts when it comes to things that go wrong for people, whether it's sailing wise or otherwise. But yeah, even in the same situation 50 different times, it all depends on the crew you have, the other variables, the weather, if somebody's sick or somebody's injured. Like, you know, even if you make different decisions or even if you make the same decision 10 times in a row, you might not get the same outcome. And that's right. Unless you've been in that position. I mean, Gandhi always said, you know, don't judge a man unless you walked a mile in his shoes, because you don't know unless you're in that situation, how you would act. And there are, regardless of what the textbooks say, there's all sorts of variables you don't plan for. And when it's dark and cold and wet and stormy and people are sick or injured, like everything goes out the window in terms of, you know, the theory of, oh, we'll just do this and we'll do that and we'll do it in that order and it'll all be nice and we'll put the kettle on and make a hot drink. And yeah, it doesn't always happen like that. So yeah, it's so true.
No, definitely not. And then also like, I feel like, and I know this cause I've done it before, is like, we like to ignore our negative aspects, right? Like we're very aware of them, but we also ignore them. And it's a weird like dichotomy of like, because I feel like a lot of people have like some degree of self-loathing because they actually know like how terrible they are inside to some degree, because everybody's got that, the balance, right? Like the line between good and evil is down the heart of every man. But for some reason, when we see like badness in a person, it's like, oh, they're all bad. Like they don't have the good, but it's like, no, they're just like you. It's like, there's bad and good within the same being.
So tell me, I mean, I've never been to South America. I've been to North America a few times. But tell me about some of your travels, whether on land or water, but you know, in terms of Peru, Chile, Argentina, Paraguay, tell me about some of your travels and some of the things you learned and some of the experiences you had that really, I guess, that really stand out for you. Because, you know, we've got people all over the world listening to this thinking about where to go next. Once the restrictions lift, goodness knows when that's going to happen, quarantine wise. But what are some of the highlights for you, Dylan?
Yeah, so I did 3 months in South America, and that was all out of a backpack. All the time I've spent in South America, I was living out of a backpack. And I enjoyed it. I liked it a lot. It was a way different experience than the way I travel now. And one of the, when I was started traveling down there, I did a lot of couch surfing. So I was just going and staying with strangers and living in their house for however long they would let me, and then I would move on. And that's a really, really great way to travel. I know that like couch surfing, the website has recently changed some things and possibly just destroyed their platform. But that concept, though, there's other platforms out there, that concept is like, it's a really fantastic way to travel because you immediately get put with locals, right? And most of the time, they'd speak your language to some degree. If you speak English, like if they're on couch surfing, most people on couch surfing speak some amount of English. And so then you're, cause like if you're just hostel hopping, right, which is another fun way to travel, but you can get like stuck with your own culture, right? Like, cause you know, likes tend to like gather together. So it's like, if you're in a hostel and there's, you know, 5 Americans there, it's just, unless I actively like try not to, you're probably just going to end up hanging out with those Americans for a little while. And now you're just like, and so that's a real great aspect. But then also one of the real fun things about hostels is that you get that mix of different cultures. So you can be in Chile in a hostel, and then you can be around an Australian, you can be around some Chileans, you can be around some Argentinians, some Germans, you know, just people from all over the world in the same place. And so that's a whole different, it's so cool. There's so many different ways that you can travel and have completely different experiences depending on how you want to do it. I like the couch surfing aspect of it. And I was really glad that's the way I started it. But then I moved into hostel hopping. And when I moved into hostel hopping, I was able to do that because I had no money. I was able to like shoot photos and like, you know, do a trade, a work trade for a place to stay. And I ended up staying in this place called Pucón, Chile for like about a month. And that place is something else. Like if you ever go to Chile and you have the opportunity to go to Pucón, it is fantastic. It's kind of like right at the base of this volcano. So you've got this huge looming volcano called Villarrica it's beautiful. And it's a presence. And you're kind of in this valley, but you're also like, if the village, the town is a square, you've got the Villarrica on one side of the square, and then you've got two bodies of water on two sides of the square, it's like this lake, and then you've got a river kind of on the other side. And so you're like, it's its own place. It's really cool. And it's got this black volcanic beach. And so I've got some drone shots of it that are just unbelievable, where you've got the blue water, the black beach, the green and the whites and the pinks of the village, and then this white volcano in the background that's just covered in snow. That's a fantastic place. And I mean, they've got all sorts of things you can do there. You can kayak the river, you can climb the volcano, you can go swimming, you can just hang out, and they've got a bunch of cool hostels there. But that's what has got like a special place in my heart, because I met some really great people there that have really impacted my life positively. That's actually where I met the first guy that I knew that had converted and lived in a van, and is probably like my introduction into like van life and whatnot. Because before I lived on the sailboat, I lived in a van for about 2 years.
And I mean, the irony is, like a yacht's just really a van or a caravan that floats, right? I mean, you know, My wife says, we should buy a caravan one day. And I'm like, we've got one. It's just got a keel and a mast on it. There's no campground, please, you know? But,
yeah. And it's just a little bit harder to take care of.
yeah, exactly. Yeah. It wants to sink. The same spirit. So, okay. And what else? What else? Tell me what else about South America.
After Pucón, I did some traveling with that guy, Alex, who had converted that van. And that was really great. And the thing with traveling is like, most of the time, travelers, people that are actually actively like out there traveling and exploring, most of the time, they're really honest people. Occasionally you get some con men, but like 99% of the time, travelers are like real respectful and honest, because they're in an environment that they're unfamiliar with, and they're kind of depending on other people's honesty and generosity as well. And so then they exude that. And so you end up in these different experiences in where you experience generosity that you just don't experience when you're living in one place, right? Like this guy, I met him in the hostel, and then within a couple days, we're both in his van and we're driving into Argentina to go climb a volcano. It's like, that just doesn't happen when you're living in a suburb. And in the whole idea of like couch surfing and like people inviting you into their home as complete strangers and feeding you and talking with you and providing you a place to sleep, it's like that type of generosity and hospitality, you don't really come across unless you're actively traveling, which I really appreciate that. And it's given me, just a deep appreciation for hospitality in general, and like a real joy of being able to host people and being able to provide a meal for people, because I've experienced how amazing that is to receive it. And some people, if you've never experienced generosity like that, like you can become uncomfortable of like somebody providing things for you, but it's like, no, they get joy out of the providing. Like there's a joy that comes with hosting somebody. And so if you know that, then being hosted is even more enjoyable, because you're like, sweet, I get the benefits of being hosted, right? Like the food and all that, the generosity. But then also I know that if I accept these things and like, and I'm happy about it and I have a good time, they're going to have an even better experience than if, cause like, I find it kind of rude. Like if somebody's hosting me and they offer me something and I'm like, no, it's okay, I don't want that. Like to me, it's a little bit rude, because it's like you accepting it gives them a good feeling. Yeah. And so, I mean, those are like some of the biggest takeaways I got from traveling in South America initially. And then I went up into Peru and went to Machu Picchu. And that place is a feat of human achievement that is really unbelievable. Like if you sit there and you ponder, how did they build this thing? It's impossible to understand. But because I feel like you can easily fall into the trap of just like walking up there, snapping a photo and be like, wow, this is cool, look how beautiful it is, and then leave and not actually like consider, no, these were people that didn't have modern technology, and they built this thing on top of this mountain with such precision and craftsmanship that, like, if you and I gave it a crack, even with modern technology, we would not be able to build something that beautiful. And so, like, the amount of skill that they have, I think it's kind of hard for us to understand sometimes, because we see like beautiful cities, right? Like you see a really beautiful town square. But it doesn't, at least for me, it doesn't naturally connect that there were people that had to construct this, and it took a lot of skill and a lot of effort and a lot of time and a lot of money to do that. And then to think, okay, with Machu Picchu, something of that level of craftsmanship or above was done on top of a mountain, along a river in a valley that is like so remote that it took me two days to walk there. And it was built like thousands of years ago. It just, that type of stuff, it gives me an appreciation for humanity that I personally find like really beneficial. And it also kind of puts it into perspective where we are in the world, because we have these modern technologies, it can give me at least a tendency to think that I'm like really great and that I like know what's going on and I'm really smart because I figured out how to make money, you know, all that kind of stuff. But it's like, in reality, I don't know how to build this computer. I don't know how to build this microphone. I don't know how to build a camera. I don't know how to build I don't even know how a hard drive works, right? Like I don't understand any of that. And I can do some, you know, I can repair the boat. I've learned a lot of things, like I can do fiberglass, I can do that kind of stuff. But when it comes to the things that actually provide me a living, which is all digital, I don't know how any of that stuff works. And when it comes to building a city or managing a city or like figuring out how to grow food and like provide, I don't know how to do any of that. And so when I see like an ancient civilization that has done something that if we tried to do it today, it would be really difficult. It just kind of gives me a sense of awe and wonder of like, what are we as people? Like, what even are we? Because like, if they're able to do that and they're just people, then what we can accomplish is so much beyond what we think we can. If we just put in the time and dedication and learn the skills that are necessary.
It's so true. I mean, when you think about it, the average person is less capable today than they were 1,000 years ago. Yeah. And when you, that's right, when you look at the technology and the research and everything that's available now, most people are capable of less. I mean, to most people today who are, you know, millennials don't have a tool shed full of tools to fix stuff. They just, you throw everything out, right? Or you get someone to fix it. It's like with your hard drive, you wouldn't even know where to start. And we're massively reliant on it, but we, you know, we unless someone else fixes it, we buy a new one. We're kind of stuck, really. I mean, it is quite amazing when you travel, that awe-inspiring stuff you see, where you just, in that moment, you just, it's hard to kind of explain, but the gravity of some of the stuff you see that you think, I'll remember this for the rest of my life. And, you know, it's just hard to explain, but it's an incredible, it's all about experiences that you gather through your life and people you meet. You know, it's not the cars you drive or the houses you live in or how big a bedroom is. You can't take that stuff with you, but, you know, I know there's something I've done with my family, my daughters at a young age, that even now, and they're all in their 20s, when I ask them, you know, what their highlights are the last 10, 20 years, it's just experiences. That's all I remember, the experiences they've had, the places they've been, the people they've met, different cultures, you know. And that's, if we do more of that as a planet, which we can, what an amazing life you can have, you know, just, yeah. It is, and the more, and like I mean, have you found that, the more that you do, the more you think, well, I can do whatever I want. Like, there's, you know, what else can I do next? Yeah. You kind of think, there's nothing I can't do. Like, you start to, all the barriers just disappear. And I mean, I was going to ask you about your, you know, your Morgan 32 yacht. I mean, you can go anywhere in the world, right? You can go anywhere in the world. Like, you know, you're not limited anymore. You've got travel, you've got accommodation. You can manage around the weather.
Yeah, I mean,
yeah, this sailboat has actually been around the world once before, and it's crossed the Atlantic both ways. So it's a solid, capable boat. It's something that I learned kind of specifically with this sailboat was the ability to like dream and imagine, because you, in like goal setting, right? Like you cannot achieve something unless you set a goal. Almost always, you're not going to get there. I mean, you know, it's the analogy people always use, like, okay, if you set off sailing and you don't have a point to where you're going, you won't go anywhere. And so the thing is that I think that's a skill. And so when I first started traveling, it was like, I'm going to travel and I'm going to figure out how to make money. That was the breadth of my imagination. And at the time, that was the biggest I could imagine, and it was the most difficult thing that I could imagine, basically. The most difficult thing I could imagine that I thought I could actually do. And then once I did that, it was like, okay, so now what's next? Like, okay, traveling by van, all that kind of stuff. Okay, the next biggest thing was like, I'm going to drive down to the bottom of Baja, Mexico. That was like the biggest thing that I could imagine. It's like, that's a crazy adventure to me. I'm going to do that. So I did that, learned how to scuba dive and learned how to sail, barely learned how to sail. And then it was like, well, I guess this one kind of came before I actually went to Baja, but it was like, what's the biggest thing I can think of now? Okay, the biggest, craziest thing I can think of that I think I can actually do is move to the Mediterranean, buy a sailboat, and live on a sailboat. I have no idea why I thought I could do that, but that was like the biggest thing that I could imagine me doing and the most difficult thing. And then I remember at one point thinking, like, while I was in Mexico, I was like, phew, if I can pull this off, I'm pretty sure I can do anything like that I set my mind to, because this is kind of ridiculously crazy to think that I'll be able to do this. And I was like really scared of just the whole prospect. It was both exciting and exhilarating, but also like really terrifying at times, to like imagine what I was getting into. But then that was achieved and I was able to do it. And now it's like, okay, what's the biggest? And now my imagination is bigger. The goal setting and the imagination, like I can dream bigger now than I used to be able to, because I've seen what I'm capable of. And known, like I've hit some walls and then I've also not hit walls. So the places where I've hit walls, it's like, okay, that's where my limits are. So now I understand that and I can use that. These other places where I haven't hit walls, like, let's figure out where that wall is. Where is that boundary? Like, what's the thing that would allow me to actually figure out what the limits of me are? And so I think that goal setting and that dream setting is a skill. And I think that sometimes we can see people that have done really great things. Like for me, Elon Musk, who's like shooting rockets into space and is running 5 different companies. And he's just absolutely incredible. And he came from South Africa, immigrant from South Africa, was broke when he started. And now he's a multi-billionaire with a rocket company and a space company. It's just so unbelievably cool. And but that's something that, like, if you don't know that it's a skill, that dreaming is a skill and setting goals is a skill, then you could look at that and just be like, well, you know, I'm just a piece of garbage. Like, there's no way I could do that. Like, look at what he's done, and I could barely, you know, keep my room clean, type of thing. But you realize that no, if you start with keeping your room clean and then making a goal, and then you achieve that goal, now you can set another goal that's bigger, and then you can grow it and work it out. And it's just a muscle like everything else. I think that's really important and helpful to know. And it's, I don't think it's something that's like explicitly taught, at least in education. It's not.
I mean, I think, being smart financially is not taught, and goal setting and turning dreams into reality is not really taught. And, you know, there's a sort of movement that came out a few years ago called The Secret, and, you know, Power of Attraction. And
yeah,
I tell my daughters, yeah, but there's a word in there called action, you know? You've actually got to take action. You can't just dream and hope and want. At some point, you've got to put a stake in the ground and you've got to take a chance. And it doesn't matter if there's 1,000 steps, but just take the first one and then the first 10. And before you know it, tell enough people about your crazy plans so you feel like you have to carry it out. And then you just get carried along this momentum, and then it's kind of too hard to turn back, so you keep going. But there is a skill, because for a lot of people, they just don't start. Like, what if I fail? What if I lose money? What if all people think? What if I get embarrassed? Like, you know, like, and you've got to kind of park all that stuff, because it's kind of irrelevant, you know. It's all external. Yeah. Because what if it works? Like, what if you succeed? What if, you know, and I've got a daughter who's in the middle of studying for something right now, and, you know, there's a lot of uncertainty, and I'm like, well, you don't, like, the certainty only comes when you do it. Like, there is no textbook to give you certainty. You kind of, it gives you a starting point, but unless you jump in, you don't figure it out. But figuring it out's the magic. Like, that's when you travel, right? It's the, all of the things that you don't know, that the richness comes from what you learn along the way that you've got to adapt and figure out. And so, yeah, I think, you know, turning dreams into goals and into reality, it is a skill, and it can be learned. And if anybody who's listening to this thinks, you know, well, you know, sorry for Dylan, he's a young guy, and, you know, blah, 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 what do you have to lose? And, like, the reality is we all come up with excuses, and we all come up with reasons why, you know, all sorts of good reasons why we can't do something or shouldn't do something. But it's amazing what you can change with your life if you just take some steps in the right direction and go down a path. And, you know, unfortunately, most of us have complicated our lives with so many layers of stuff and commitments and finances and expectations. But if you strip all that away, it is amazing what you can do. And, you know, I mean, some of the stuff I've done sailing-wise now, I mean, the great thing about that is, like, you know, the day-to-day challenges that you have in life, you think, well, that's not going to kill me, so how bad can it be? Because if you face, you know, some danger in your travels or your adventures, and you face, you know, am I going to eat tomorrow night or am I going to sleep? You're like, it just puts all the other stuff puts it back into scale, really, back into perspective. And some of us think that, you know, things are this big, but they're actually, in the scheme of the planet and how small we are and the opportunity, if you can just put all that stuff aside and say, you know, what other people think of me is none of my business, and, you know, and just focus on just taking a step, it is so true. And, you're such a great example of that. I mean, for someone in their 20s, I'm so excited for you about what you've achieved, but my God, what a rich life you've got ahead of you. Because some people are just getting started in their 50s and 60s, or they go, I'm going to retire and buy a boat, and then before they know it, you know, somebody's health part fails and their dreams get shelved and they're lifted too late. I mean, you're a great example of you can start whenever you want to start, really. At the point you say, I'm gonna do it, reality is for most of us within a few months we can, if we really, really want to. I mean, you're Morgan 32, just tell me a little bit about, you had about 7 day sailing experience and you said, I'm going to buy a yacht, I'm going to go sailing next. Like, yeah. How did it come about? Like, in terms of, I think Arianrhod, is that how you pronounce the name of your yacht?
Mm-hmm. Arianrhod, yeah.
So how did you find that Morgan 32? How did you decide that's the boat for me? And how did you end up owning a stunning yacht like that with a great story, particularly given it's sailed around the world? Like, that's, you know, again, yeah. You don't need a 45-footer or a 50-footer. I reckon the smaller the boat, the better, really. It's easier to maintain.
Well, I kind of stumbled into it. It's one of those things where it makes me think of, I don't know if you've read The Alchemist, Paulo Coelho. In that book, there's a quote, and it says, you know, when you want something, the whole universe will conspire to help you achieve it. And if you read that and you just read it really quickly, you think, oh, well, that's, you know, that's a load of bull. Like, I want a lot of things. But if you understand what it means to actually want something, right? Like, to actually, if you want something, you'll reconstruct your whole life so that you get it. Like, wanting is also an action. Like, you have to prove it with how you're living your life and what you're doing to it, to achieve it. And so if you really want something and you create your whole life in the direction into achieving that, it's really strange. Like, synchronicities happen and things come through that are just unbelievable that they would happen like that. Like, I found this sailboat on Reddit. And I found it because I went on Reddit and I asked, this is what I want to do, Mediterranean, blah, blah, blah. What kind of documents do I need so this is legal? Because I don't know anything about sailing. And they're like, so this is what you need. One guy was like, yeah, it's impossible to do by April. But this other guy was like, okay, it's not that hard. This is da, da, da. By the way, I'm selling a boat because I just moved onto a catamaran, blah, blah, blah. And so I talked to him and he gave me a price and I was like, okay, that's too much. And it's like 4 months from when I need it. And I've never seen the boat and there's no survey. So it's like not happening. So I just stopped messaging him. And then a month later, he came back with half the price. And I was like, okay, so let's go ahead and just keep this conversation alive. And then it ended up happening that about just like 5-6 days before actually moving on to the sailboat, I ended up agreeing to buy it and moved on to it as soon as we got to Barcelona. And so from the like conception and the decision of saying I'm going to move to the Mediterranean, that happened in like November, and then moved on to the sailboat in May 6th. So it was literally 6 months, less than 6 months, going from like idea and conception to reality. And then then it was like reality and there was a lot of stuff to do and you had to figure stuff out. But like just the actual achievement of getting the sailboat was, yeah, just about 6 months. But it worked out. And the boat's a super solid boat. And I've done a lot of work to it and put a lot of time and energy into it, but it all just kind of came together. Like, we came across, there's three of us in the beginning, we came across the Atlantic on a ship, on a cruise ship, a transatlantic cruise ship, repositioning cruise. So they're relatively affordable when you take into account all the benefits that you get from them. And so the ship landed in Barcelona on May 6th. We got off at like 8 a.m. and then by like 1 p.m. we're on this boat. So it was just perfect. It's like the boat happened to be in Barcelona where the ship was landing. It's like, how is that possible?
It is amazing how things line up once you have a focus and you go in a direction. Like, people line up, opportunities line up, people know people they refer you to. And also... Yeah. Like, if you don't ask, you don't get. Like, it's amazing if you're a reasonable person. I mean, I don't think I've ever told anyone this story, but the the yacht I currently have, which I'm in the process of selling to buy another one, I never set out to buy that yacht. My plan was, and this is 2011, so 9 years ago, my plan was I'm gonna find an owner who's got a yacht for sale. It's been for sale for a long time, and they're not using it. I'm gonna offer to rent their yacht on a monthly basis while it's for sale, to keep it kind of like actively working. I'm gonna take my family sailing and see if they like it. That was my plan. So I contacted a bunch of people. Most of them said, get lost. One guy said, oh, that sounds interesting. Come for a sale. Went for a sale. This is a Beneteau 45. Went for a sale. Beautiful yacht. And he says, okay, well, to be honest, we've bought a 55-footer in the Mediterranean. We're leaving next month to fly to the Mediterranean. This is from New Zealand. I don't really want to rent my yacht out because I want to sell it. But give me a proposal. You seem like a nice guy. Tell me, why don't you buy it off me instead? And I kind of say, well, I can't. I don't have the money to buy it off you right now. I'm, you know, business and blah, blah, blah. Yeah. So I gave him a proposal where I said, I will just pay you some payments for a monthly payment for the next 2 years. And at the end of 2 years, I'll buy your yacht outright. And if I don't like it, for whatever reason, I won't. And you can keep my money. And if I do, great. And so literally, I put $2,000 down and sailed away in a $250,000 yacht. And then spent the next 2 years making small payments. He flew to the other side of the world with his family and started their dream trip on their next yacht. He'd had this yacht for sale for a year and a half, so he was about to walk away and leave it on a marina. And then eventually through business, I was extremely motivated to work really, really hard to build up my business, to ensure that I could pay for the yacht in 2 years. And that's how I bought it. I never set out to buy it. And only because I asked the question and I saw a guy who had a yacht for sale for a year and a half, he's about to walk away and leave on a marina. But if I'd never taken that chance, it never would have happened.
Right.
And so for people who are listening to this and they think, oh, yeah, but you don't understand my circumstances. It's not possible for me. You know, it's too hard. It is quite amazing if you just start looking, the opportunities that come along and the people you meet along the way and people that actually want to help you. I mean, I've kept in touch with those people, John and Kerry. They're lovely people. Great, you know, great friends. They've followed my adventures. I've followed theirs. They're just great people. And so it is amazing the people that are out there. And sometimes when we live in these small communities, we see the same neighbors every day and they don't wave over the fence. We kind of assume the world's kind of selfish and mean, but it's actually not. I think, you know, most of the world's generous and kind. And also generosity has nothing to do with wealth. Some of the most generous people, most giving people, some of the most hospitable people that host you, it's nothing to do with wealth or income. It's just how they're wired, right? It's just how they think and how they see the world. And so, it's easy to think the world's how we see the world, but actually the world's not how we see the world. The world's everything, in every direction. Everywhere you go, you'll find kind people, you'll find people that aren't kind. But equally, if you focus on something and you've got a grand plan, it's amazing the people that will put up their hand and often get behind you or help or contribute or open doors for you.
Yeah, it really is unbelievable what will happen if you just try, if you just go for it and just see what happens. And one of the things that I think holds a lot of people back is fear, right? Like they're afraid that it won't work. They're afraid they'll fail, or they're afraid that, you know, something bad will happen and they won't be able to recover. And so I learned this from Tim Ferriss, is this concept of fear setting. So instead of thinking like, okay, what am I going to do? Like, what's the best that could happen? It's like, sit down, think, what's the craziest thing that you want, this goal that you're trying to achieve? What is the absolute worst case scenario? And then after you write that out, say, take some time and go, okay, now if I'm in that scenario, what would I have to do to get back to where I am right now? And 9 times out of 10, like the getting back to where you are right now is less than 2 years worth of work from the worst case scenario that you can imagine. And so if you think about that, it's like, oh, there's actually not much risk here. It's like, I think people we have a tendency to blow risk out of proportion and think things are way riskier than they actually are. And it's like with asking, what's the worst that could happen? They say no. It's like, okay, so then you just move on. It's like, you're in the same spot than you are now. It's like literally nothing happened.
Yeah, literally, you're not going to die.
Literally nothing happened.
Yeah, you're not going to die. You're not going to lose everything. You know, life will carry on. And a week later, they'll forget you even had the conversation, right? It's not going to be headline news for the rest of your life.
Right, and you didn't lose any money from it. You just asked.
But what if it works? What if they say yes? What if?
Right.
What if it leads to a door that opens that changes like what you do for the next 5 years?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Figuring out risk judgment is extremely helpful, and I think can like really propel people forward in their life, because most people, it seems, do not judge risk accurately. And so if you can like figure out some sort of accurate way to judge risk, then you can like take smart risks, and then it also depends on like what your tolerances are. But I mean, you know, I only know my own experience, but it's worked out well for me so far.
That's right, absolutely. And the worst that can happen really ever does, you know, and usually these options are on the way. And even if the worst does happen, you get up, you lick your wounds, and you're wiser for it, and you carry on. But yeah, you can never develop any sort of tolerance for risk if you can't start living with uncertainty and taking risks, right? You'd actually never find those walls or overcome all the limitations. So, I mean, for you, Dylan, I mean, in terms of, I'm just conscious of time as well. But in terms of your sailing now, where's your sailing taking you? And given your adventures on land and now on water, where to next for you? You know, the next, I mean, given how you like changing 5 years, I did ask you about a five-year plan. But in terms of what does the next 5 months look like?
So bought the boat in Barcelona, sailed to Albania, basically hit some countries in between, from Albania up to Croatia, hit the countries in between, Montenegro, back down to Greece, through Greece, up through the Bosphorus to Istanbul, and then, well, up through the Dardanelles to Istanbul, and then from Istanbul, I sailed to Bulgaria, and then from there, sailed back down through Greece, and then to Malta, and then to where I am now in Tunisia. So I've hit Spain, France, Italy, Albania, Montenegro, Croatia, Greece, Turkey, Bulgaria, Malta, and Tunisia. So 11 countries on the boat so far. And so now we're just waiting for the border to open in Malta because of COVID, but it should be opening quite soon. So then we'll sail back to Malta, then cross over to Greece, spend the season in Greece, whatever's left of the season, and then start working our way to the Canaries. And so the original plan was to cross this December, but that's not happening. So we've got another 18 months before we're going to cross, which is actually really nice because it takes a plan that was like kind of rushed to like really relax now. So we can go to Greece, spend the time and see all the stuff that I want to see in Greece. And then I'll be like done with Greece, kind of. At least I'll have explored enough of it that if I never went back, it would be all right, I guess. I mean, Greece is just so fantastic that I would love to go back. But and then, yeah, work our way to the Balearics, spend some time in the Balearics, and then spend some months, probably a couple months in the Canaries, and then cross the Atlantic, and then spend the season in the Caribbean. So right now the plan is cross the Atlantic in December of 2021, and so then the spring of 2022 be in the Caribbean, and then most likely be back in America by the summer of 2022.
Wow, that's fantastic.
So that's the plan as of right now.
Well, that's excellent. It really is. And you've had some incredible travels, and I mean, to have you to be able to travel by sea and keep building the business and the following you've built is just such an incredible example. It really is. You are the first person in my life, just so you know, that I've ever met who's had 100 million views on YouTube. So, and given you are you 26 now, 27, 26?
I'll be 26 in July.
Okay. What day?
27th, July 27th.
I'm going to be 50 on the 18th, so there you go.
Okay. There we go.
So, that's fantastic. I mean, Before we, in terms of, and I'll link to your Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube channels from the Ocean Sailing Podcast website and from our Ocean Sailing Podcast Facebook group as well. Just before we wrap up, are there any sort of last thoughts last stories, last bits of advice you want to share?
I mean, it's, you know, wherever you are in your life, if you can just take some time to sit alone by yourself for however long you can bear and just think about, where am I in my life and where do I want to go and what do I want to do? And it's not an easy thing to figure out. It takes time to actually answer those questions. So don't be frustrated if you don't come to an answer and the first time you like sit alone with yourself. And then think about like, what is the smallest step that would move me in the right direction? Because that's all you have to do, is like take one step at a time, whatever that is. If it's just, well, I want to become a world explorer, but I'm afraid to, and blah, blah, blah. It's like, what one step can I take? How about you explore someplace in your city that you've never been? Start with that. It's super approachable, whatever it is, to what degree that works for you, the smallest step you can take. I think people will be like, in my experience, I've always been surprised with what I've been able to accomplish and achieve. Like, you'll be able to surprise yourself of what you're capable of. You're definitely more capable than you think you are, and you're definitely more capable than you realize. And it's just worth it to try, because you have nothing to lose. And like, we're all gonna die. So it's gonna end. Like, this world, our existence is gonna end. So might as well give it a shot and see what happens. Because really, what's the worst that's gonna happen?
That's such good advice. And if you just read a book, do some research online, do a course, go for a drive in your car, go driving around boat yards, you know, look at boats for sale online. Just do something that starts to inspire you and draw you. You just get drawn into stuff, right? Because then you start talking to people and people know people, and it's so true. But just do something. Baby steps. Doesn't have to be much, but you'd be amazed how one step leads to another, and before you know it, you know, you get carried along that train. So that's great advice.
Yeah. Do something. Be patient and just keep moving forward.
Yeah. And something that draws your mind and your focus out of your day-to-day life or rat race or whatever it is you do that you want to do, you know, differently in the future, just take some time out and force yourself to create that space to get your head into the clouds and out of day-to-day life. Turn television off one night a week. Turn your TV off. Just sit there dreaming, yeah, and training and researching and reading. You'll be amazed what you can find 4 hours a week. You know, I always tell people, multiply it by 50, right? 50 weeks a year, 50 mm-hmm. weeks a year. If you just spend 4 hours a week, 200 hours a year, working on your plan or your goal or your dream, it's amazing how much momentum you can create with 20 hours, let alone 200. So just start somewhere.
In your life, the things you remember are experiences. And it made me think, one of the things that you
don't remember is time spent on a screen. You don't remember it. There's never, there's a few like really poignant films that I've seen that have impacted my life. But other than that, the vast majority of time spent on my phone or just on a screen, you don't remember it. It's not the things that like make those grounding foundational experiences. So yeah, take some time away from screens if you can.
That's a good advice. Well, Dylan, it's been a pleasure meeting with you and talking with you. Just, you know, incredible young man. And I really do admire your courage and your determination and just your drive and ability to just take on new challenges. And I'm sure you've had lots of setbacks along the way, but, you know, just an incredible human being. So, I mean, it's just...
Thank you, David.
A real inspiration to talk to you and to be able to share your story as well. And then I'll link to... of your channels, but I'd love to stay in touch, and I'd love to connect with you again in the future as well, because I can tell your life's had 100 chapters already, and there'll be 100 more in the next 5 years, let alone the next 50 years. So
yeah, we'll see what happens. Thanks for having me on, David. I really really appreciate it, and I had a great time talking to you.
It's truly been a privilege. So thank you, and thank you so much for sharing your story with everybody, because it really is inspirational. It really is. So I'm sure as a result of this, people will do some different things next week and next month and next year than they would have just by listening to what you've done. So thank you.
Thank you. I hope so. And try my best. So thanks for having me. Talk to you later.
Thanks for listening to another episode of the Ocean Sailing Podcast. Email your comments and suggestions to david@oceansailingpodcast.com.au. See you next week.
To a different place where love is not illusion based, and fear is just a word they can't define. Where I've heard hope and happiness are found in every beating chest, cause all those hearts are more or less inclined to give it all away without fear of what's to break. The answer that we never seem to find. The hand we always take disintegrates without a trace, and we're the ones they've always left behind. Help me understand, the best is yet to come. Take me by the moments pass me by, but I refuse to leave my life to fall between the cracks of my control. I was outspoken till I broke open all the chains that were imprisoning my soul. Help me understand, the best is yet to come. Try to swim the other way, and they'll never let you see another day.
But I've been there before, I've been a soldier in this war. If you take it in your stride, you might just see the other side. Just breathe, breathe, cause everything you see is just a stone.
Understand, the best is yet to come. Take me.